Luckily, I grew up in a very educated community, you know, 30 minutes away from MIT, Harvard, you know, all of the Ivy Leagues in Boston. And I think that speaks a lot to kids and their value system, but their manners and so forth.
Sure.
So I don't remember getting teased too much. I'm sure I did, and how much of that I have sort of put under the surface and forgotten about. But I have a tougher time even today when I'm in an inner city environment where the people surrounding me don't have the same etiquette and don't have the same education, the same exposure.
Mm-hmm.
And that's really where I struggle more than where I grew up, in a suburb of Boston.
Well, to get a bit more of that sort of educated thought and idea, I want you to tell us, you know, as a medical condition of dwarfism, what do you know is the cause of shorter stature, and in particular in your case, what is the cause of this?
Well, remember, there are over 200 different types of dwarfism, achondroplasia being the most common. So if you were to meet another little person in your life, most likely they'll have achondroplasia. So I can only really speak to achondroplasia.
Okay.
It is a dominant gene. It is also a mutation. So what that means is an individual can have achondroplasia for two reasons. One would be their parents have it, and it's been inherited, as it was with my children. The other would be it's a genetic mutation, which is a complete unexplained event, which is what it was for me.
Sure.
Yeah.
Are you familiar with the gene that is actually mutated in most cases of achondroplasia? The FGFR3 gene.
That's it. That's what I am.
Okay.
There's a reason I don't teach science. I'm an English and drama teacher and Spanish teacher, not a science teacher. So yes, very familiar. I don't spend a whole lot of time conversing about it. What is really, really cool is that when the gene was discovered in 1994, in 1992, the National Convention was in San Francisco. I was 8 months pregnant. We had both my in-laws there as well as my parents. And when we have a national convention that Little People of America puts on, a gaggle of healthcare providers fly in that have specialized or have an interest in dwarfism. And so there'll be no less than 15 or 20 geneticists from around the country. Sometimes we even have international geneticists. And we all volunteered ourselves for a blood draw when I was 8 months pregnant. And they sent me home with a vial for umbilical blood that I was, when I was going to give birth a month later, so that they could get umbilical cord blood. So I like to say we had a little bit of something to do with the discovery of the gene 2 years later.
Are there any advantages to having a slightly shorter stature in general?
This is a very common question, and I always say to myself, I've got to write it down, because I never, you know, am fully prepared, but in this instance, I did think about it some. Let's start with the disadvantages, because that's a shorter list.
Mm-hmm.
The grocery store is horrible, and I haven't quite figured out the best time to go. If I were not little, the best time to go clearly would be 6:30 or 7 in the morning when I'm awake, because it's not crowded. But it's a very bad time for me to go when it's not crowded, because there aren't people in the aisles to turn to and say, can you hand me that jar up there? So I think the compromise is more like 10 a.m., you know, which fortunately, because I don't work full time, I can do that. And I can always pretty much count on waiting no more than 2 or 3 minutes for somebody to show up in the aisle. I'm not going to go to customer service every time I need help. You get very savvy at flirting with people to get what you need. So I will strike up a conversation instantly, with the main motivation being that I need that can of tomatoes at the top of the counter. Other disadvantages, it really depends. It's hard to go into communities that are less educated and less mannered, because we are so comfortable in our community, which granted has gotten to know us on so many different levels over the last 20 years. My husband and I, both our careers, myself as a substitute teacher, and he as an IT guy for small businesses in our immediate area, we're very well known, only because people don't forget us. You know, it's not a comment on our personality. However, I've been told that we sort of have magnanimous personalities as well. So we get really comfortable in our environment, and then when we step out to a different environment and the reaction is totally inappropriate, it's a slap in the face. It's a reminder.
Can you, I mean, if you're comfortable, can you give us an example of a negative reaction that you've
experienced?
I
can give you two, and they're a little bit different. One of them was pure ignorance. There's nothing more upsetting to me than to be in an environment where it's the adults that are grabbing the children and saying, look at the midget. Come here, Frankie, come look at the midget. I cannot believe that in this day of age that's still happening. But when I go into inner city environments, in a grocery store, you know, grocery stores are really harsh places for me to be, not only because of the physical thing, but you're trapped. You know, you're in a grocery store line, and you can't go anywhere. And you've got kids with their fingers right 5 feet away from you, and you're trapped. So that is definitely, you know, hard. The other example of ignorance was an educated ignorance, if I dare say. The five of us were on our bikes in San Francisco by the Palace of Fine Arts. We'd been riding our bikes around, and we rode in front of a tour bus with tourists from another country. We can pretty much assure you that when we go by a tour bus or a group of tourists from other countries, those video cameras are trained on us like snipers. And my husband has gotten to the point, he's a very, very patient man, but he will walk right up to the camera and say, you will delete that picture. He gets very upset.
Imagine.
And imagine having 50 of them on your family. You feel like there are snipers on you.
Let's go back to some of the advantages.
Oh, yeah. Because that's a longer list. It really is. Advantages. Let's see. Well, here's a hybrid. Why don't we do the hybrid first?
Okay.
The spotlight is always on.
Fair enough.
So you can be entertaining and the life of the party, and everyone wants to talk to you.
You could get a special spot on Tales from the Genome.
People remember me. That's kind of the spotlight too, but if I want to jog somebody's memory over the phone and I'll say, hey, this is Ginny Foos, your little customer. Oh yes, how are you? So I get the information quicker.
It's an identifier.
Yeah. When I get tickets to a show, the tickets, I can say I need good tickets, and I get good tickets.
Nice.
So that's an advantage. We went camping recently, and I was able to stand up in my tent and change my clothes, whereas the average size friends could not.
I've definitely encountered that problem before.
Yeah.
Not all of us are 6'5". Anything, what about airplanes?
Oh, yes. Airplane travel is, I would argue, more comfortable for me, but the difference is that my feet are dangling. Look at right now, and yours are not. So mine are going to maybe go to sleep. But when I've gone on a long flight, if there happens to be an empty seat next to mine, I can actually lay down. The flight attendants don't like it much, but I can.